have a suffering India on the other. And the gap between these two is widening. And that is where I come down to all of you. Your normal classroom is how long? 40 minutes or 50? 90 minutes. I won't have the stamina to speak for that long. Because we were lucky. In our times, the class used to be 45 minutes at the most, 45 to 50 minutes. So I always used to, as the president of ESFI, I always used to tell our student leaders, and never speak beyond 45 minutes. Because beyond that, there's no concentration that goes in one class. But 90 minutes, I think you're different. So that is where I come down to finally to your profession and what you're doing. Normally, it's the normal pastime in our country that the politician is to be blamed for everything. To most of the things, he is responsible. There's no doubt about it. Because eventually, it's politics that will determine how many such institutions will be there in India, how many students will get admission in these. All these are finally, in the final analysis, these are political decisions. But just like you have people and people, you also have politicians and politicians. And that is where, at the point that comes up, is the future of our country, if it is, has to be determined, that is a very big management exercise. You are the future managers in our country. And in that management that you will do, apart from your earning your bread, earning your salary, selling soaps, I mean, all that you do, I mean, nobody is denying that. But remember, the solution to a country's problem is actually a management problem. Here I have 1.1 billion people, out of whom 77% are unable to have 3 square meals a day. Here is the amount of food grains I have. Here is the amount of potential of my agricultural produce that I can produce. How do I distribute that amongst these people so that we all can have a comfortable life? The management problem. This is the need of the power that I require to eliminate poverty in my country. I require so much of energy when nearly 50% of households do not have direct access to electricity. Nearly 3/4 of our area villages do not have scientific sanitary conditions. That's why the climate change talks, I mean, last time in Copenhagen and now, we are saying that it's countries like India that have sustained this planet. I mean, we don't use any product, I mean, whenever for our sanitation thing, I mean, except for natural water, I mean, nothing else that we use, I mean, tons of paper and tons of forests are denuded for your toilet paper to be produced. I mean, that apart, only the lighter weight of things. But then, if today I want to improve the plight of my people, I'll require energy. This is the potential I have. This is the potential that I can achieve. And how do I do that? That is the management problem. So in the final analysis, all of you with all the talent that you acquire, all the expertise that you acquire, will also have to use that expertise for improving our country as a whole. And that's why I said, apart from what you will be doing individually, give it a thought. Give this a thought, because what we are reaching in the world today is a situation where, and management is one such discipline, where it is no longer a multidisciplinary approach. It has actually now transcended to become a transdisciplinary approach. Like multinational corporations have transcended to become transnational corporations. Your discipline and your approach on in terms of managing this will have to transcend to reach the transnational, the transdisciplinary levels in order to solve the problems for our country. And that is where I am beseeching all of you, that you are all at an age where the adventure of ideas is what propels all of you to move forward. Dr. Anup Saha and I were just discussing in our generation, when you had those turbulent times of the late 60s, early 70s. He's a year senior to me. And when there was passion involved in everything. You could be right wing, you could be left wing, you could be centrist, you could be everything. There must be passion involved now, I don't know, we have gone old. But that passion, devote a part of that passion to actually to improving your country, which has all this potential. Please, we will require to all of us together to change the mindset that Our asset is our youth. Today we have 54% of our population is below the age of 25. If we can give them education, if we can give them health, if we can give them employment, then a better India is automatically created. Are we in a position to give them that? That is the management problem. We have our resources. Instead of allowing them to be looted, if we marshal them properly, yes, we can build a better India. So to give our youth, treat them as the asset and not as a liability. And the parliament the other day, luckily, I won't say luckily, because the last whole entire winter session, people were saying, I mean, you see, you are looking very tired, government, you've been working hard. I said, yes, we've been working very hard to make sure the parliament doesn't work. And then that is what happened. One whole session went away. That's a different issue, the obduracy of the government refusing to accept the JPC, etc. But the parliament is seized of a population policy, where the thrust is to reduce the rate of growth of our population. Correct. I mean, nobody will deny that. But the thought process or the mindset is what? That this population that we have today is a liability. Unless you start thinking of this population as an asset of yours and convert your what you think your liability into an asset by providing them health, education and employment, then a new India is obviously in the making. Nobody can stop it from happening. Now the biggest obstacle to allow that potential, for stopping us from realizing that potential, is this crony capitalism that we are seeing today. So that is why this is no longer an issue of politics between opposition and the government. Everybody, and that is what I've told the Prime Minister on the floor in front of him, I'm telling him outside wherever I have the opportunity, that sir, if you think crony capitalism, India can ill afford crony capitalism, then please exercise the authority of the Prime Minister and the government to stop that from happening. And we can stop it from happening if we can only cleanse our politics and make sure that these unscrupulous elements do not carry the day. And that is why, my dear friends, the question of crony capitalism today is important. Only to sum up, is important for us not merely as a moral question to stop the loot of our country's resources, not only as a moral question in order to punish those guilty of such loot, not only a question of preventing the collateral damage that occurs both to our environment, to all the other natural resources that we have, like water, dumping of waste, but to prevent the collateral damage it has on democracy and democratic structures itself. And then, more importantly, to stop this from happening so that these legitimate resources that accrue to our society through the government are used for improving the lives of our people and are used to creating a better India. And that is why it is not, as I said earlier, a topic, an issue that can be brushed aside and saying that, well, if he is dishonest, what can I do? I'll be honest in my life. No, you have to stop him from being dishonest if you want a better India. And there, you'll also have to contribute as management experts, as potential management experts, in putting in your might, your contribution, to help the country manage the objectives that it has, manage from the available resources to achieve what is required for our people, and with the obvious expectation that all of you will rise to this occasion, because remember, you will inherit this country, my generation will be gone, and you decide how to what sort of a country you want to inherit, and please come forward and contribute for creating that sort of a better India with this confidence that you will do so. Thank you again for giving me this opportunity.
Very good evening, sir. You made a point earlier about how the whole corruption and the crony capitalism and how people in the government aren't exactly doing stuff to prevent it. As a party which has earned offers and opportunities in the past to join the government, and having stayed out of it for one time and having almost said no to the Prime Minister's post a decade and a half earlier, don't you think that being in the government would have aided you in this particular venture, both staying out of it and saying, okay, let me see how it goes? So, is that something which you have always looked back and said, okay, I should have done better on that?
There's this old saying, I mean, economists will tell you, it's the tail that wags the dog when the marginal cost that comes in. But that's not the case in politics. When we did not join the Prime Minister, or did not take the Prime Ministership, it was a situation where we had 32 members of Parliament and the majority required was 272. So there would have been a situation where we would have been presiding over a cabinet which could have indulged and which did indulge even then in high degrees of crony capitalism. And we couldn't prevent it because of the coalition, the numbers that you have. So there are pros and cons of that because it's not necessary that once you're inside, you can prevent the others from not doing what they're doing. Because you've seen the IPL scam, a lot of fingers and needles of suspicion of being pointed to various people in the cabinet. You'll have such situation. Therefore, going inside is not a guarantee that we could have stopped it. But the point that issue is that there is also a written question. Somebody said that you were in coalition with the UPA when the 2G scam happened. You walked out on the nuclear deal, but why not in this issue? Why are you taking this issue only after the CAG report? That's not true. When we were supporting the UPA government, there used to be this fortnightly meetings called the UPA Left Coordination Committee. This issue was taken up then a number of times. And in February 2008, when we were still supporting the government, the first of the three letters that I had written to the Prime Minister on the scam, saying that this should be stopped and what needs to be done, the first letter was dated in February 2008, when we were still supporting members. So it's not that, we didn't take it up earlier or we're taking it now for some political reason. We've been consistently pointing it out. But the point is that their whole point is even today, they claim they have their coalitional pressures. So that's why they're not able to do something. But to the main question that you raise, it's not necessary being inside we could have stopped such things from happening. That requires the strength in order to stop it. Unfortunately, we have not yet acquired that strength. Yes.